And yeah, one of the objects that we want to connect with other infrastructures are the specimens. So we want to connect the specimens data with sequence data that's derived from them. We want to connect the specimen types with the names in Catalog of Life, etc. But we have a problem for that to do that, because we don't have persistent identifiers, and we need to have identifiers that are really persistent, because our collections remain relevant for hundreds of years. So we need to have identifiers that are equally persistent to connect with other data in other infrastructures. Okay, we have slides up now. Next slide, please. So this morning you may have attended the annotation session, where there was a lot of talk about digital specimens as a new object on the internet that should be a one-stop shop to find all the information related to a specimen. And to make that reality, the most important thing is to have that identifier, that new identifier. And for that, we have chosen to use DOIs. DOIs because there is a foundation behind that, the DOI Foundation, that ensures that the identifiers are maintained indefinitely, as long as they exist. And they are especially organized with purpose for that, and they exist already 20 years to do so. The digital specimen is you can see as a bag of links, so it contains all the older specimen identifiers as well, local identifiers or globally identifiers for the physical specimens. So here you see an example of a herbarium specimen that has a catalog identifier, catalog number, and also a global identifier that leads to the web page from the catalog. And you see an example of how these new identifiers for the digital specimens could look like in HTML page, where it could easily have a tooltip that shows the relevant metadata, including the other identifiers, so that you can easily verify that identifier is the correct one that you are looking for. And next slide, please. So we use the DOIs. DOIs use the handle system. And what a DOI does, basically, it resolves to a PIT record with some metadata. And that PIT record redirects to a web page. The advantage of that is that the PIT record, which contains the URL, can be modified. So if the URL changes, then the DOI will not longer resolve, but you can fix that by changing that URL in the metadata record. And next slide, please. The handle system actually has some extra advantages. And we want to use them. So one is that we want to store the metadata in the PIT record. So usually a DOI PIT record only contains the URL that it redirects to, but we want to have it additional metadata, which can then be used by machines to figure out whether that's an object of interest without having to download the full specimen record. And that's used by adding the nodirect option that works for all DOIs. Or handles, actually. We also have an option to redirect, to have a multiple redirect. So we can have that DOI redirecting both to a human readable version, a GUI version, a HTML page for the specimen, but also to a JSON version. So we will always have these two redirects included in the DOI. And we can also retrieve a specific version. So by default, we want to link that DOI to the latest version of the specimen. But because we see the digital specimen as a mutable object that changes over time with new annotations, new additions of data, You may want to include in your reference a specific version of that objects, and you can retrieve that by appending the version number to the UI. So we keep only one identifier for all the versions of the objects. Next slide. So this is how it looks like. So we have some metadata in the PID record, which we call the FDO record, fair disk to object record, to be compliant with the FDO work that's being done. And that contains, for instance, a machine readable version of the profile of that metadata record, but also a type of the digital specimen, where you can find out a JSON schema for the object, for the specimen object, but also the operations that you can do as a machine on that object. Next slide, please. So there are different parts in that metadata. We have some PID kernel information, who issued the PID, what date was the PID issued. We have some specific metadata that is stored for all the UIs by all the registration agencies. And then we have some metadata that's specific for specimens in there as well. Next slide, please. One thing I forgot to mention is that we only store metadata that does not change very often in the metadata records. We also have metadata that changes much more frequently, like the determinations of the species. We store that in the data itself. We have also created some vocabularies for that PID record. For instance, discipline and whether the specimen is living or preserved. So that can be used by machines to find out whether it is an object of interest for a specific service. And next slide. So some characteristics of the distal specimen DOIs. Each DOI for this specimen must have this metadata in the handle record. It must be licensed as CC0, the metadata. The data itself may have a different license, but the metadata should be CC0. Each DOI type must use the same metadata schema, but may be of a different version. Each handle record must point to a machine readable type definition that describes the structure of the data and supported operations. So each specimen could have a different data structure, but you can retrieve the structure. It must redirect both to a JSON and a HTML representation. And if it's versioned, it must be possible to redirect to a specific version of the object. Next slide. So I wanted to do a short demo of creating a DOI and making some changes to that, but because of the hybrid setup of this meeting, I cannot do a live demo. But this is the workflow that we have. So we ingest some data in Disco coming from a CMS. And we check if a DOI exists already for that specimen. If not, then we create a new DOI. But if it exists, we check if it's up to date or if it needs to change, we change if needed. And then we create a new digital specimen or we update the specimen with the latest information coming from the CMS. I have a recording that I can show of creating a new DOI, so maybe I can do that 2 minutes. If you want to see a live demo, we can do that over lunchtime. Yeah, and then just contact me. Okay, can we start the demo? So we created an API with an upshot API that can both create and update DOIs. So this is a distal specimen page. for a specimen with a storage name, a Heteromastis filiformis. Not yet running. Interesting. Okay. I have, yeah. Okay, you see here the distal specimen page. It has a physical specimen identifier, which links to a URL. And here you see the call that we make to the UpSearch API. We see we need to enter the location to which the DOI needs to resolve. That's our sandbox. We need to enter the type, this distal specimen, and the organization that is hosting the specimen. Now we have created the DOI, and we can go to that DOI. And you see that it links to this specimen page. And now we enter node redirects to see the metadata. And here you can see the metadata that has been created. And that's part of the DOI. So you see the type, distal specimen, and you see the name of the specimen and the hosting organization with an ROR. This is the DOI, and here you see the location that it points to, in this example one location. Okay, that's it.
Yeah, we don't have much time for questions, but we will have a discussion of half an hour at the end, so please keep your questions for that time. This is really, really impressive achievement, I think. DOIs for specimens already working. So the next on stage is Guido Sauter from Platzi, who will tell us about bidirectional linking mechanism from the literature.
Thanks, Lubo. As you already mentioned, I'm Guido, and I'm